Good evening, everyone. My name is Nate Jaros. I'm curator of fish and invertebrates here at the Aquarium of the Pacific. First, I'd like to start by thanking our lecture sponsors, the Gazette newspaper and the Courtyard by Marriott. But tonight, I have the pleasure of being both one of your presenters and a moderator, so I'm just going to kind of jump right into my presentation. Tonight's lecture is titled The Aquarium's Largest Exhibit, Part 1, Tropical Reef Habitats. We're typically asked to do these sort of lectures to highlight our conservation work or work with sustainability projects, and I was excited that when I was asked to give or to lead a two-part lecture kind of on the inner workings of the Aquarium of the Pacific. A lot of things that we do are very interesting and we often take them for granted. But tonight we're going to be doing the first installment of a two-part lecture series on our largest exhibit, Tropical Reef. The first night is going to be all about the animals, and the second night on the 23rd of September is going to be kind of a how does it work. We're going to pull back the curtain and take a look at the mechanics and the filtration, what we do to take care of the water and the diving and the cleaning, which will be really fascinating as well. So please join us for that. But tonight I have the pleasure of sharing the lectern with Janet Monday. She's our assistant curator of fish and invertebrates, and she oversees the Tropical Pacific Gallery, which is the central and largest feature, for which Tropical Reef is the central and most large feature. Janet's worked with the aquarium for 11 years. But we'll also have Aquarist 2, Lauren Samarov, who's the primary aquarist responsible for Tropical Reef, and has been working with the exhibit for just about a year and a half, but she has made quite a significant impact. Lauren's been with the aquarium in total for about 4 years, although that was not consecutive. We're starting the slides here with a bird's eye view, an impressive bird's eye view of the Aquarium of the Pacific. And if you look a little closer, you can see the where the skylights are highlighted there is the area above our tropical reef habitat with some natural lighting. And if I pull back and remove again, you can see the floor plan view with this large gray kind of oblong heptagon being our tropical reef habitat. And this smaller sliver over here is called soft coral garden. These are both part of the same system, although the animals don't have the ability to cross back and forth. And if you look, the guests, as they enter where the blue arrow is, they'll see the first window. That's the entrance to the Tropical Pacific Gallery for a section that we call sunny exposure. Guests will navigate around the exhibit clockwise, going through a tunnel, looking at a small design feature, and then culminating with the large aquarium window that's 44 feet by 9 feet tall, which is a large curved window representing the largest and most open space of the exhibit. Tropical Reef and Soft Coral Garden, the total volume of these two combined systems is over 360,000 gallons of water, and there's over 1,000 animals present. The deepest point of the exhibit is 28 feet deep, and there are 5 distinctive viewing windows. As mentioned, one is a very large 44-foot long window. It traditionally served as the grand finale of the Aquarium of the Pacific experience, and it takes a great many people to make it run, to make it work. We have people from multiple departments, from those who care for the animals to those who care for the filters and the system, the electronics, the interpretation, the education, the list goes on and on. There's too many people to mention that are involved with the successful navigation of the Aquarium of the Pacific in general, but with the Tropical Pacific exhibit in particular. The theme of the Tropical Pacific Tropical Reef Habitat is based on a very particular reef in Palau, and you can see on this map where the red balloon is indicating where Palau is. It's about 500 miles to the east of the Philippines. And the there's a 3D model here that this is a photograph taken actually at the Palau Aquarium that really shows the underwater topography. The islands of Palau, for which there are hundreds, are surrounded by an enormous lagoon area. This is indicated by the kind of the green seafoam area. The islands are smattered throughout this archipelago. The brick red coloration represents volcanic island. It's a subtle distinction, but the brown sections are island, and the kind of the beige sections are actually just barrier reefs that are subsurface. If you look in this photograph, you can kind of see the islands in the foreground, and you can see this discoloration in the water in the distance. That represents the barrier reef. The lagoons surrounded the island are naturally warmer than the surrounding ocean water, just because they're shallow and they're relatively close to the equator where the sun is bright. So the average temperature in Palau is around 28 degrees Celsius or 82.5 Fahrenheit year round. These naturally warm lagoons create an environment where corals may have been adapting for thousands of years. So this is particularly important when the areas of coral restoration and research, they can study these corals that may have already adapted to slightly warmer temperatures, and that could be applicable to other areas of the Pacific where oceans are warming. AOP has contributed to research both in Palau and in neighboring Guam for a number of years, working on research and coral restoration projects with partners. Here's a satellite view of the islands of Palau, and this is going to be used to indicate very precise features of our tropical reef habitat for which this is modeled. First, if you look closely, you'll see these small channels. There's the German channel and the Oolong channel. These are the first features that you're going to experience when you enter the gallery and look at the tropical reef habitat. These channels are deeper sections of water on the barrier reef, where water channels through with the tides at a rapid rate. And this water movement brings in nutrients, water motion, which attracts the animals and the prey, and the whole food web kind of aggregates in these. So they're a beautiful spot for diving. It's a very popular drift dive, where if you're dropped off at the right place at the right time, you drift right through this channel and it feels like you're flying through, and the sand is actually moving like water in a river beneath you because the current is so strong. But corals and fish, like I say, just thrive in this environment, both with the nutrient-rich water and the water motion. So naturally you'll see animals like gorgonians and other corals that can filter the water. And a section of our aquarium that's kind of modeled after this is our tunnel area, where you're kind of walking through the sand channel and you have reef slopes on either side of the canyon. The next feature that you'll incorporate is the what we call Blue Hole. There's a dive site called Blue Hole. It's just right along the barrier reef on the top of a very shallow reef. You can see where the surface is and where this diver is. There's an opening that leads to a vertical cave that goes down to about 100 or more feet before opening up to the open ocean and to the reef wall structure of the barrier reef. If you look closely, you can see these divers in the scale of this, and they're at about 90 to 100 feet right there. And looking back up, you can see kind of the hole in the sun where they came from, which kind of gives it the name Blue Hole. The aquarium has a very small window. We call it affectionately the Coke can. It's a half cylinder. This is kind of designed with the Blue Hole in mind, where you can look up and see the sunlight coming naturally through the skylights, and the rock walls are designed to make you feel like you're immersive and that you're inside a cave. And then the highlight of our tropical reef habitat is our Blue Corner exhibit. So this is the big window, the 44-foot window that I referred to, that represents this reef wall of the outer reef slope, where there's a lot of life, a lot of motion. There's a blue wall in the distance that represents the open ocean and serves as the grand finale. Now, to bring all these different features of Palau and these wonderful dive sites together, I want to thank our volunteer diver, Ken Curtis, who regularly leads expeditions out to Palau and other areas around the world for diving. And he has put together a nice video that kind of incorporates. And just to set it up, there is so much water motion on this outer reef, outer barrier reef at Palau, with the tidal motion that comes in, brings in a huge amount of velocity, which brings in the nutrients and concentrates the prey items, which brings the fish. So it makes for a spectacular dive. It's a relatively simple dive on a slack tide or in between the tide exchanges, but during the tide, divers actually will clip into the top of the reef wall and basically water ski in the current and just watch the amount of animals, the amount of fish, the amount of large sharks that come in to feed on the tidal exchange. So you just sit back and watch the show. So thanks to the musical stylings of Creedence Clearwater Revival, we're going to play a video brought to us by our volunteer diver Ken Curtis to highlight the blue corner dive site. Down at the blue corner, but I'm going to go ahead and pass the lectern over to assistant curator Janet Monday, who will introduce you to some of the very special animals that call Tropical Reef home.
All right, thanks, Nate. Well, as Nate mentioned, this exhibit has many different species, over 1,200 individuals and almost 170 different species. I'd like to give you a brief introduction into the different types of animals living in this exhibit. The first one is our Queensland grouper, which can get to be up to 8 feet long and 800 pounds in the wild. These are found off the coast of Northern Australia, and this particular animal has been in this exhibit for 20 years. You can see a full picture of the animal on the left-hand side, and the picture on the right-hand side, the grouper's mouth is getting cleaned by a cleaner wrasse. Cleaner wrasses have stations around the exhibit, and sometimes you can be lucky enough to catch a larger fish getting cleaned like this one. We also have two eagle rays, a male and a female. We got them as juveniles, and they were about 8 pounds and had a 2-foot wingspan. And in the course of the 3 years that we've had them, they're now 125 pounds and almost 5 feet across. And their tail alone is close to 8 feet long. We do have some other cool ray species. The first one is a cow nose ray, named after their nose, which looks like a cow's nose. They're a smaller ray with about a 2-foot wingspan, and in the wild can be found in large schools of thousands of rays. We have 17 in this exhibit. We also have a southern ray and a mangrove ray, both an impressive size with about a 5 to 6 foot wingspan, and they weigh approximately 180 pounds. During our dive show, our mangrove ray feeds against the acrylic window, which is really cool to see. We have two main shark species in this exhibit. The first one is a bonnethead shark, which is a type of hammerhead shark. So there's 9 different species of hammerhead sharks, and this one's the smallest. It's called a bonnethead because of its rounded nose. Our female's about 4 feet long, and she's one of my favorite animals in the exhibit. We also have 2 zebra sharks. One of the sharks was born and raised at this aquarium, and the other one we've had for 17 years. When they're fully grown, they reach about 8 to 10 feet long. They have very small teeth, and in the wild, they will eat invertebrates when they find them in the coral reefs. We have 2 olive Ridley sea turtles at the aquarium, one in this exhibit and one in our shark exhibit. These 2 were confiscated at the Dallas airport in 1994 when a woman was caught smuggling turtle eggs in a jar. They were taken to the nearby Dallas Zoo where they hatched and were deemed unreleasable. They came to us a couple years later. The aquarist that was caring for them named them Thelma and Luis because we knew they were siblings, but we weren't sure if they were male or female. And turns out they're both males, so we've shortened their names now to Theo and Lou. We also have a green sea turtle in the exhibit that came to us on loan from SeaWorld San Diego earlier this year named Copper. He's still young now, but when fully grown, he can reach up to 350 pounds. 75% of his diet consists of vegetables like romaine lettuce, bok choy, green peppers, and broccoli. All right, so some of the other fishes we have. The most common type of fish we have in this exhibit are surgeon fishes. We have 29 different species and well over 100 individuals. These fish have a scalpel that sits in a groove toward the back of their body that they can use against predators and to show dominance on the reef. If you look at the upper right-hand photo, you can see a good picture of their scalpel. These fish eat a mixture of small plankton in the water and algae. They do a great job cleaning algae on the reef, and in many of our large coral exhibits, as you can see in the top video. Some of my favorite surgeon fish that we have in this exhibit are called unicorn fish. These fish have a prominent horn or bump on their head, and we have many different species, like the humpback, which is the first one you see on the top left, the hump nose right underneath it, the big nose, which is on the top right, our spotted, and also the blue spine unicorn fish. All unicorn fish have actually 2 scalpels, as you can see in the blue spine unicorn fish at the bottom. Another family of fish represented in this exhibit are triggerfishes. And these are an example of some of the triggerfishes that we have. If you look at the clown trigger at the top right corner, you can see a spike on its top dorsal fin that all triggerfishes have that's used for defense to wedge themselves into tight places. All triggerfishes swim using their second dorsal fin on the top and their anal fin on the bottom, which makes them highly maneuverable, swimming forwards, backwards, or just hovering. Also pictured on the bottom right is our Picasso triggerfish and the vampire triggerfish on the bottom left with its red teeth. And it's really cool to see these vampire triggerfishes. We have a school of them, and you'll see them making their nests in the sand and interacting. So they're a really cool species to watch. We also have trevallies, which are a close relative to the tuna. These are some of the fastest fish in the exhibit. We got these golden trevally when they were young and bright yellow colored about 15 years ago. You can see a video and another picture of the golden trevallies. The species on the bottom right is a blue trevally, and we have several of those as well. Our volunteer divers call these fish the motorcycle gang because they swim to all the feeding stations to try to get extra food. So that's some of the species that we have, and there's so many other species that I could talk about. We have an eel, we have snappers like our emperor snapper, sailfin snapper, we have a huge school of monos, angelfishes, a flying gunnard. One of my favorites is this silvery fish that swims really quickly called a look down. And I have to mention bubbles, a particular batfish that loves to swim in the exhaust bubbles from divers during presentations. So please come to visit some of these animals. Now I'm going to turn it over to Lauren, who will talk more about how we can feed and care for all of these animals in the same exhibit.
All right, thanks, Janet. I'm Lauren, and I'm the aquarist in charge of Tropical Reef, and I'm going to be talking about what we feed our animals, how we feed them, and why we choose to train some of them. As Janet explained, there's a huge diversity of animals in Tropical Reef, and with that comes a wide variety of diets. We have bottom-dwelling carnivores, large predators, schooling herbivores, and tiny fish that live in coral rubble throughout the exhibit. So we have to offer a lot of different food items in order to meet all the dietary needs for our animals. And we feed this exhibit over 30 pounds of food every day. Now, the preparation for food preparation for Tropical Reef is one of the largest, most complex at the aquarium. It takes about an hour and a half to complete, and it's usually done by one of our amazing husbandry volunteers. We feed a variety of restaurant-quality, sustainable seafood, and we try to provide a diet that's similar to what these animals would be eating in the wild. We offer items like mahi-mahi, crabs, clams, krill. We offer a lot of different food items for this exhibit. And we also weigh out every feed to maintain our animals' weights. So if we notice an animal is looking over or underweight, we'll adjust their feeding amount based on our daily observations. Now, just like us, fish need vitamins. So even though we are feeding high-quality seafood, some of the nutritional value is lost in the freezing process. So we have to supplement to make up for that. Some of our animals need specific elements in their diet to stay healthy. All of our sharks and rays get a specialized vitamin that contains iodine. All sharks are without the proper amount of iodine in their diet, they can actually develop goiters. So it's essential that they get this vitamin. We also have specialized vitamins for our sea turtles. And then the rest of our fish, we use a liquid vitamin solution that's added to their diets called VitaFish. So in addition to vitamins, we have to make sure that they're getting anything else that they need in their diets to be healthy. Spotted eagle rays need hard-shelled food items in their diets. They have these large crushing plates inside of their mouths that they use to crush open bivalves and crustaceans that they find in the sand. Not only is this part of their natural diet, it's essential to the health of these animals. Now, as their plates get worn down by the process of cracking those shells open, the dull plates will fall out and be replaced by new ones. And if these animals are not provided with hard-shelled food items, these plates can become overgrown and can result in the inability for this animal to eat. So it's really important that they get these food items. And we offer our spotted eagle rays whole clams and crabs. Some of the clams that we offer them are the size of my fist. So these guys have really powerful jaws. And if you happen to be outside of the exhibit, you can hear the shells cracking from the public side. So it's pretty incredible. So this is why it's important for us to know the natural history of our animals so we can ensure that they're getting an appropriate diet. So what about our vegetarians? In the ocean, herbivores will graze on algae that grows on rocks and other surfaces, but in Tropical Reef, we scrub that algae away to keep it looking clean. So we supplement with a few other items. We feed a ton of vegetables to Tropical Reef. We feed a variety of lettuce, cucumbers, kale, cilantro, so many other things. And these are placed throughout the exhibit on what we call veggie plates, which are just round perforated discs that the vegetables are attached to. And this gives fish that naturally graze on algae an opportunity to graze on something similar. And we offer different vegetables on a regular basis to give them some variety. It's always really fun to see what the fish like and what they don't. The fish hate parsley in Tropical Reef, but they love cilantro. And cilantro is one of my favorite things to feed out because it makes the entire third floor and the dive lockers smell like it. And we also feed out dry roasted nori like you would find in a sushi restaurant. And additionally, we feed out pellets and flake food that you would feed to a home aquarium, but just on a much larger scale. So now that you know what we feed our animals, let's talk about how we feed them. If I were to throw that 30 pounds of food into the exhibit, only the largest, most aggressive fish would get anything to eat. So, and we need to ensure that all of our animals are getting an appropriate amount of food. And we do this by utilizing a few different feeding methods. Feeding Tropical Reef is an orchestrated event. At minimum, we have 8 people feeding this exhibit at one time. We have 4 people on the surface targeting animals that come up to feed. And at the same time, we also have 4 divers in the exhibit targeting the rest of the animals. Now, it's key that the surface feeders and the divers are synchronized. And the goal of this is to keep the aggressive animals distracted long enough so that we can feed our slower animals. Now, it takes an army to feed this community tank. So let's talk about the first feed, which is called a scatter feed. A scatter feed is a feed designed to target a large amount of animals with a similar diet. If we tried to individually feed every surgeon fish in Tropical Reef, it would take forever. So we utilize this feed for a lot of our smaller fish. We'll do scatter feeds of pellets at the surface, and then we'll also take squirt bottles down in the exhibit full of nori and krill that our divers swim around with to feed our smaller fish. Now we also use a different type of scatter feed to target some of our larger aggressive fish like the golden trevally. These fish are extremely fast and aggressive, and these are the fish that would happily eat 30 pounds of food before our stingrays even knew that it was feeding time. So we have to keep these guys distracted long enough so that our slow animals can eat. And our slowest animal takes about 15 minutes to eat, so we have to keep them engaged for that amount of time. We use a little bit of trickery by spinning around, having the fish follow the food. We'll also do fake outs where we pretend we have food, but we don't, just to keep these fish engaged with that particular diver. At this station, the diver gets completely swarmed by fish. It can be really disorienting the first time you do it because all you can see is fish. You can't see which way is up and which way is down. But that being said, it's one of my favorite stations to feed. So while our aggressive fish are being distracted by a scatter feed, we use a target feed for the slower animals. A target feed is meant for a specific type or group of animals. All of our elasmobranchs, sea turtles, and our largest fish are target fed. Target feeding allows us to track exactly how much food an individual is getting. And this helps us maintain healthy weights and ensures that animals are getting those essential vitamins that they need. So while our biggest fish, the Queensland grouper, comes to a diver to receive its target feed, some of our animals come to a physical target to receive their diet, and this is called target training. Both our sea turtles have physical targets, and they are only fed if they come to and stay at their target. Our green sea turtle has a blue and white buoy that he uses as his target, but we have an additional cue for him to let him know that it's feeding time. We use an audible cue for him, and it is a very high-tech piece of equipment. It is a metal strut that we lower down into the exhibit, and we bang it 3 times with a metal clamp. Now, the reason we chose to add this audible cue for our sea turtle is that these guys are notorious for sticking their heads under rocks and in caves, so half the time they can't even see their target. So when he hears this audible cue, he knows it's time to start looking for his target so that he can eat. Now we can go even further with target training to something called stretcher training. All of our elasmobranchs receive annual physicals, so we know that we have to catch them out at least once a year. And you are never going to be faster than a shark. So it is much easier on the animals and on us if these animals are trained to participate in their care. We do this by incorporating their capture devices, which are large vinyl stretchers, into their target feeds. Now, our zebra sharks still have their training wheels on, so to speak. This is what we call a mock stretcher. It's much larger and easier to get in and out of than their actual stretcher, and they're really strong with feeding out of this mock stretcher. So pretty soon, we'll start incorporating their real stretcher into their feeds. We also stretcher train our spotted eagle rays, and we catch them out more regularly than our other elasmobranchs. So this training has been crucial for their care. Eel rays are susceptible to parasites called monogenes, which are a type of flatworm that attaches to the host's skin and gills. And in dense enough numbers, this parasite can actually kill an eagle ray. So we have to make sure that we treat these animals for this parasite. And we give our eagle rays a preventative treatment to help keep these monogenes at bay. And we treat them with a medication called praziquantel 3 to 4 times a year. And in order for this treatment to be effective, we have to catch the animal out of the exhibit, move it to a smaller holding tank where we can get the praziquantel in a high enough concentration to actually kill those monogenes. Now, when these animals were first introduced into Tropical Reef, they were only trained to feed off of a ramp. So we started adding their stretcher. We draped it over the ramp, which is that blue vinyl stretcher there, so that they would get used to feeding on their capture device. Once they were comfortable with that, we started adding snorkelers into the water. In order to catch these animals, you need to have people in the water. So we needed to add these snorkelers to desensitize them. So at first, the snorkelers would just kind of hang out next to the platform, not doing anything. And then once they were comfortable with people being in the water when they fed, we started the actual stretcher training. Now, for the stretcher training, the animal would swim up to receive its diet, and the snorkelers would lift the bottom of that stretcher up, creating a little pool, and the animal would continue to be rewarded until it was ready to leave, and then it would be released. So if we were to actually capture this animal, there would be more people standing on top, and we would like really trap the animal in there, and then those people would grab it from the two people in the water. So we were able to utilize this method for over a year, which is great, but eagle rays have exponential growth rates, and it's really easy to lift a 50-pound eagle ray out of an exhibit, but once they reached 100 pounds, it started getting increasingly difficult. So, and this is an actual growth rate of our eagle rays. The last weigh-in for our female, she weighed in at over 125 pounds, so these guys are pretty big. Now, luckily, we have a crane on top of the exhibit to lift large animals. So we completely changed the stretcher training for these animals in order to utilize this crane. So their new stretcher is attached to a metal ring that can be attached to a bridle that can then be attached to the hook on the crane. So slowly, we transitioned the stretcher from the angle of the ramp to be completely horizontal, creating a pool for the animals to swim into. And this allows us to mimic what it will be like when we need to catch them for their treatments. So where we are now with their training is that both of them are very comfortable coming into the stretcher to eat. And for the first time a few weeks ago, we did a trial run where we lifted the stretcher with our male eagle ray with the crane, and it went really smoothly. It's much safer and more efficient than using snorkelers. And hours of time and energy went into training these animals, and we're really happy with the direction it's going in. As these animals continue to grow, we'll have to continue to evolve their training. This could range from getting a larger stretcher to making the crane more efficient. The training for these animals is never over. We always have to be thinking ahead. So the last thing I want to talk about is something called enrichment. Now, enrichment is defined by AZA as a process for improving or enhancing animal environments and care within the context of their inhabitants' behavioral biology and natural history. So what does that mean? To put it really simply, it just means anything that's going to make these animals' lives better. So all of the stretcher training we just talked about, that's considered enrichment because it enhances their care. And we use a lot of different types of enrichments, and I'm just going to talk about a few that we use in Tropical Reef. So at least once a week, we do a scatter feed of crabs, and our rays love crab day. And this is really great for them because this allows them to exhibit the natural behavior of digging through the sand to find food. Most of our rays are trained to come up to feed off of a ramp or a window, so it's great to let them exhibit that natural behavior. Now, we also feed out something called gel rocks, which are rocks or artificial coral that we coat with a gel-like food. And fish love to pick at this. And our green sea turtle also loves to graze on this as well. And again, this is allowing these animals to exhibit a natural behavior. Now, we also have physical enrichment devices that we give to our animals. This is Lou, our Olive Ridley sea turtle, with his enrichment device. And just like you would give your pets at home a toy to keep them active and engaged, we do the same thing with our animals in Tropical Reef. Lou was notorious for swimming around the exhibit, biting at the rock work, ripping artificial corals out. So this enrichment toy gives him an outlet for that energy. And since we've introduced it, he has stopped exhibiting that behavior. So while enrichments are meant for the animals, they're oftentimes enrichments for us. It's really exciting to see your animals get excited about a new food item or to see them use an enrichment device that you spent time working on. So all of this information really just scratches the surface of what it takes to care for all of the amazing animals that call Tropical Reef their home. And we are also passionate about the health of these animals and that we work with, and we put a lot of energy into making sure that they're happy, healthy, and living the best possible life that they can. I'm gonna hand it back over to Nate.
Excellent job, Janet and Lauren. I'm so proud to work with such dedicated and talented people. I'd also like to send a special thank you to everyone who contributes to the care and welfare of our aquariums and our tropical reef in particular, including our veterinary team, our life support technicians, our dive safety staff, our facilities and education development, and the rest of our aquarists, along with everyone else that works here at the aquarium. Everybody plays a role to deliver our important messages to the guests. We rely on hundreds of volunteers also. There's certainly, last but not least, our paid staff are outnumbered more than 3-to-1 to volunteers. We're very reliant and we're very thankful for all of their hard work and dedication, particularly with our Tropical Reef Habitat. In the absence of a live audience tonight, I've asked Janet and Lauren to join me up on stage, and I'll ask them a couple of questions on your behalf. All right. Lauren, let's start with you. Can you tell us more about the animal training process? How long does it take? I didn't even know, or a lot of people may not know, that you can train fish to do things. So tell us a little bit about how much investment that is, how much time it takes.
Sure. It varies based on the type of training you're doing. So target training can be pretty quick, like our green sea turtle. Honestly, he picked it up super fast. And the way you just introduce that is during a normal feed, you just put their target next to them, and then eventually they associate the target with food. Stretcher training is a whole nother process. I mean, where we're at with the eagle rays, that has been like a year and a half of work. So this stuff doesn't happen overnight. If you move too quickly, especially with stretcher training, you can actually regress in the learning from these animals. So you have to be really, really patient. So it takes a long time, and patience is key.
Thank you. I am, even though I see it every day, I'm just constantly amazed by the dedication that we have, all of those different types of food, different delivery methods, different strategy. Tell us more about, I guess, there's just the combination of animals that we keep together, and how do we mitigate the predator-prey relationship in a mixed species exhibit like this?
Yeah, the key with a mixed predator community tank is making sure that those predators get enough food so that they don't go after the prey items. So we will feed our predators basically until satiation. And for our smaller fish, there are lots of habitats throughout the exhibit that we create for them to hide in if they feel like they're in danger. But we keep a really close eye on these interactions, and basically it's just making sure that those predators are getting enough food.
Great. Janet, when you were giving your presentation, you talked about the Queensland grouper that we had for more than 20 years and these trevally that lived for 15 years, that we've had for 15 years. What sort of expectation would you like to share with people on how long fish live in an aquarium?
You know, that's a really good question. We have had our grouper, our sea turtles for at least 20 years, the trevally for 15 years, and the list goes on and on. I think that we've been able to maintain a really good animal balance in our large mixed species exhibit, so I think that adds a lot to it. And we give them everything that they need, too. They get fed, you know, every day. They have perfect water temperature. So they have a lot of these factors that I know even animals that are in the ocean are struggling with. But yeah, it's a great question to know how long they will live. I know some species of grouper can live 55 years and even more than that. I'm excited to see how long these guys will live.
That's great. That's certainly a testament to the quality of care that you and our fellow staff provide. Why don't we talk just a little bit about the pandemic and how that might have affected or changed how work is at the Aquarium of the Pacific, but in special regards to our animals. Lauren, is there anything, any corners that you've had to cut since the pandemic?
Yeah, I mean, the way that Tropical Reef is fed now is honestly completely different than before the pandemic. Before we had 4 dive feeds for Tropical Reef, and now we just have 1. So in order to make sure that these animals are still getting everything that they need, we increased diets. We took some dives and made them into surface feeds. So it is really different now. And we also don't have as many volunteer divers. So the staff was doing a lot of the diving during the early part of the pandemic. So there were days where I prepped the food and then I was diving, feeding, and then I would get out and it was like the day was over.
Well, thanks for all the hard work. I saw it in action. It was truly impressive. A lot of dedication here at the aquarium. So the indoor exhibits are still unfortunately closed at the Aquarium of the Pacific. You can certainly come check out our outdoor exhibits. But Janet, is there any way that we can share these wonderful animals in Tropical Reef with our loyal following?
Yeah, if you tune in to explore.org, there is an exhibit there called the Tropical Reef Exhibit, and you can click on that, and there's a webcam, and you can see in live time all the animals swimming around. If you tune in, you might get to check out a feed that we're doing during that day. So yeah, I invite everyone to come and check it out, and you can see a lot of the animals that we've talked about and even see some of the feeds as well.
Okay, Lauren, I'll put you on the spot. What is your favorite thing to do in Tropical Reef, or the most rewarding experience that you have?
Doing the feeds is pretty rewarding for me. Interacting with the animals on that basis is really important for me. But there are some things where we do a lot of maintenance in this exhibit, and we've recently added a lot of new corals and drilled a lot of new holes to put those corals into. So it's really satisfying just to see your hard work pay off. And because Tropical Reef is such a big picture kind of exhibit, it's really nice when all of those ideas come together and like your goal is met.
Great. And Janet, you talked about all these different animals, and I know that Bubbles is a clear favorite with our volunteer divers, but do you have a favorite animal in Tropical Reef?
Oh, that's a great question. You know, I think one of my favorite animals is our bonnethead shark that we have that we've had for so many years as well. She's another one that we've had for so long. But yeah, I love feeding her, and she's a little more shy and cryptic, but she'll just come right up to you to feed. And I think my favorite animal would be a bonnethead shark.
Okay. Well, thank you both for talking with me. And thanks for the great lectures. It was great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thanks for everyone for watching at home. And this video presentation will be archived at aquariumofthepacific.org and on Aquarium's YouTube page. Please be sure to tune in on September 23rd when I'll lead a new panel for a second and final installment of the Tropical Reef series entitled The Aquarium's Largest Exhibit Focused on Care and Maintenance. So we'll see you on the 23rd. Thank you.